Good afternoon, folks. We're here from Partick Free Church of Scotland continuing. We meet on the Lord's Day, that's Sunday at 11 a.m. and again 6:30 p.m. We meet at 2 Thornwood Terrace. That's just off Dumbarton Road, opposite the police station, up the hill, beside Thornwood Primary School. And we would extend a warm welcome to you all to come and to worship God, to hear about the person and the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're out here this afternoon, as we do on regular occasions. We're out bringing something of the good news of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to you this afternoon. We'll be handing out some gospel tracts, and we would be delighted if you would take one and read it, of course. We know everybody's busy and everybody's after your time and after your attention, but we want to bring to your attention the most important thing that anyone can bring to your attention, and that is the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, that one who came from heaven, and he came on a mercy mission. He came in order to seek and to save that which was lost. And it's remarkable when you think that the Lord Jesus Christ, being the second person in the Holy Trinity, the Son of God, who dwelt in glory and honor and peace and felicity all the days of eternity, came down to this world on a mission in order that he might save. And we are delighted to inform you today that his mission was entirely successful. There on the cross he cried out, "It is finished." And there he was declaring to those who watched him die, to the angels, to the devil himself, and to God the Father, that the Lord Jesus Christ had successfully completed the mission that was given to him. And that's why we have good news to come on the streets of Glasgow this afternoon to tell you about the person and the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. I suppose it would be accurate to say that most people today would say, yes, they do believe in God, but also that it would also be true to say that many people live like practical atheists. What does that mean? Well, it just simply means that most people today live their lives without any reference or without any thought about God. They get up in the morning, they do whatever is required to get them out and about, maybe go to school or university or college or their work. They go about their daily duties. When the time comes, they come home, they have their meal, they do whatever they want to do, watch television, browse the internet or whatever, and then they're off to bed. And during that whole day, there's never a thought, there's never a word about God, about the one who made them and formed them. And most people go through their lives day after day without any thought of God, any thought about his word, any thought about his person, any thought about the fact that one day they will meet him. They seem to be oblivious to all of these things. Well, friends, there is no excuse for the practical atheist. And there's no excuse even for the person who would say that he is an out atheist. I want to read one or two words to you this afternoon from Paul's letter to the Romans, to Romans chapter 1. When the Apostle Paul wrote these words, or this book in Romans, he was in Corinth. He was in Greece, and he was looking upon the society as it was in the first century in Corinth and in Greece. And in the second half of chapter 1, he describes the society that he saw all around him. And I want to read one or two verses of his description of that society in Corinth in Greece in the first century. It says in verse 18 of chapter 1, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse." Now, we do come across people who claim to be atheists, and they are dogmatic and determined. They say there is no God. Has the Bible got something to say to such individuals who say there is no God? Well, here in these verses that I've just read, there are a number of things that are addressed to people who call themselves atheists. First of all, the Word of God tells us that every one of us hold the truth in unrighteousness. Everyone. We're all made in the image of God. Adam was made out of the dust, and he was made in the image of God in knowledge, righteousness, and holiness. Adam, when he was created, had perfect knowledge, he had perfect righteousness, and perfect holiness. He was just like his maker. Yes, Adam had a body, a physical body, but God does not have a body. God is a spirit. But he resembled his maker in the fact that he had perfect knowledge, perfect righteousness, and perfect holiness. And we know, of course, things change when Adam sinned. But Paul was writing here to Adam's descendants. And they were ones who were sinners, but he was able to say to them, regardless, who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Now, what kind of truth are they holding in unrighteousness? Well, the truth that he's principally talking about is the truth that God is, that God exists. And it's very important for us to realize, friends, the knowledge that every single one of us has by nature, because we're made in the image of God, is not a vague knowledge. It's not a knowledge that we know there is a God or a vague kind of God. The knowledge that every one of us possesses because we're made in the image of God is we have a knowledge of the one true and living God. In other words, we have a knowledge of the God of the Bible. That is built into us. We might say in modern parlance, it's in our DNA. It's part of our being as human beings. God has put that in us, that knowledge. And as I said, as I read the word to you, it says we hold that knowledge in unrighteousness. What's he talking about? Well, he's telling us we have this knowledge, but we hold it. And we hold it in the sense that we hold it down. We don't like to live up to the reality of it. And an illustration might help us. If you've ever been in a swimming pool, I'm sure you've had. And if you've ever had a ball with you, if you have that ball, you put it under the water, it will instantly come up. But if you hold it down, it will stay down. That's the kind of knowledge that the natural man has of God. He wants to keep that knowledge submerged. He wants to keep it down. He does not want to live up to the light of the fact that he knows God, and God is a reality to him. That's why the Bible never ever seeks to prove that God exists, because you all know that God exists. Now, what is the truth that you want to hide under? What is the truth that the atheist will not live up to? Well, the truth is unfolded for us here in these verses that I read. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them. God has revealed himself in some sense to us internally. How did he do that? Well, God has put his law in us. Again, it's part of our makeup, it's part of being a human being, it's part of our DNA. God has put the law of God in our hearts. We have the law of God codified in the Word of God. We have it in the Ten Commandments. But every single one of us has it in our hearts. And God has also given us a conscience. And in some sense, the conscience and the law of God are linked together. They register one with the other. And therefore, when the gospel preacher talks about the law of God and the fact that every single one of us has broken God's law, our conscience will condemn us. Our conscience will rise up and speak and testify to us. Let's put it in another way. When you do something wrong, when you lie, when you cheat, when you commit fornication or adultery, when you do these things, what happens? Something inside you registers and says, hold on, sir, hold on, madam, you have done something wrong. Where did that come from? It came from the living God who made you and formed you and who put his law in your heart and the conscience there to regulate that when you break God's law, your conscience will condemn you. That's what it means here when it says, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, an internal revelation. That's what all of us have by nature. And that's what we want to hold down. We don't want to live up to it and recognize it. But the Bible goes on and says something more. We not only have an internal revelation of God within each and every one of us, God has also revealed himself outside. It goes on. For God hath showed it unto them. He has shown the truth of his existence unto them. Where has he done that? He's done that in creation. Friends, here we are in a city in Glasgow. But we're surrounded wherever we go with God's creation. And creation is a 24-hour, 7-day week, 365-day of the year sermon to us all. It is telling us clearly and plainly that because creation is real and we're all living in it and we all see it and we all appreciate it and we all enjoy it, it is testifying to the fact that there is a creator. We are not like those friends who believe that the world came into being billions of years ago by some great big bang and life came from some kind of cell, primitive cell. That clearly is nonsense. Nothing can come from nothing. And the very fact that there is something, creation, that we're all in, it testifies to you and to me that there is a creator. And the whole point of this, friends, is to make us realize, as the Bible goes on to say, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen. Where? In creation. Being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. We are without excuse. If we are ones who say that God does not exist, we have no excuse. We are denying the very information that we have within us and without us. Within us, in the law of God being written upon us, and our conscience testifying to that law of God, and also to the glory and the wonder and the spectacle of the creation that God created in 6 days by his word and by his power. Therefore, friends, when we come to you this afternoon and we seek to talk to you about God, and about what he has done in the Lord Jesus Christ, It's not a fairy story. And what's more, you know it's not a fairy story. You know it. You know the things that I'm saying to you are true. How do you know that? Because your conscience, although it may somehow be sleeping, and although it may be in some sense ineffective, as John Knox said one day, your conscience needs to be fed. Nevertheless, your conscience is there. It's real. And it's telling you, despite my infirmities and despite my faults and failings, the conscience is saying to you today, this man is telling you the truth. He's telling you the truth as it is in the Word of God. And therefore you are to measure up, and you are to realize that there is a God. And God is all around us. God is a spirit, infinite, eternal, and unchangeable. It is being, wisdom, power, holiness, justice, goodness, and truth. He is the great God of heaven, the one who made all things and brought all things into being, the God who made our first father out of the dust and made our first mother out of Adam. And from them, the whole of the human race came into being, and we are part of it. And God has made us for a purpose. Yes, God has made every single one of us for a purpose. Our catechism would tell us. Man's chief end is to glorify God and to enjoy Him forever. Many people today will tell us that life is without purpose. Indeed, this is the very mantra of the atheist. And if there is no God, then life is pointless. But there is a God, and there is point and purpose in life. What is that? As our catechism tells us, man's chief end, man's purpose in life is to enjoy God and to know Him forever. That's what we want to speak about this afternoon to you all. We want to tell you how this is possible. Because if we go back to the very beginning, if we go back to Genesis chapter 3, Genesis chapter 1 and 2 talk about the creation, talk about the sun, the moon, the stars, the animals, the plants, and then ultimately God creating man in His image. But it also, in Genesis chapter 3, we are told about man's fall. What happened to man? Man who was made in the image of God, man who was perfect in knowledge and righteousness and holiness, what happened to him? He listened to the evil one. He listened to the serpent. The serpent came and tempted Eve, and Eve succumbed to the temptation, and she handed the forbidden fruit to Adam, and he ate it also. And from that time, what happened? Sin came in to man's experience and existence. And all the bad things that happen to us in this world, in this life, can ultimately be traced back to that time when sin entered into our experience. Before that, Adam and Eve did not know about sin. They were perfect. But when they listened to the evil one, then sin came in. And what has sin brought? Sin has brought tears. Sin has brought suffering. Sin has brought bad weather. Sin has brought thistles, thorns, weeds. Everything bad that we find all around us, that has been brought upon us by sin. And because Adam and Eve sinned, something happened to them. They died spiritually the moment that they ate the forbidden fruit. What does that mean? It simply means that the wonderful relationship that they had with their Heavenly Father, with their Creator, was broken. Because God is a holy God. The prophet Habakkuk says of God, "Thou art of purer eyes than to behold evil, and canst not look upon iniquity." God dwells in light, unapproachable. He is burning holiness, pure light. He cannot sin, and he cannot tolerate sin. And therefore, because of that new relationship between Adam and God, it had to be broken. How can it be restored? That's the question. Well, mankind cannot restore it. Religion cannot restore it. Politicians cannot restore it. Armies and fightings and wars, whatever, they can't restore it. Those who educate us in our schools, in our colleges, in our universities, they cannot address the problem. They cannot reconcile us to God. The industrialists, those who create our wealth, they cannot answer this problem. They cannot meet it. Only one person can do this. It's God Himself. He is the one who has been offended by our behavior, because having come from Adam, we're all sinners. That's why the Bible tells us plainly, bluntly, for there is no difference, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That simply tells us that by nature we are estranged, we are separated from God. And by our good works, by being charitable, by living a good life, by being religious itself, we cannot be reconciled to God by these methods or by any other method. There's only one way. And what way is that? That way is through the Lord Jesus Christ Himself. What does the Bible say? What does Jesus Christ Himself say? He says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. And when He says no one comes to the Father, that's a reference to heaven. No one can possibly get to heaven and be with the Father and enjoy the blessedness of heaven unless they come through the Lord Jesus Christ and Him alone. That's why Jesus said, I am the way. He is the way. And this is what real Orthodox Christianity teaches. We do not believe for one moment that there are many ways to God, that there are different routes to God. Like as if you're going to some city, if you're going to Edinburgh, there are various ways that you can get to Edinburgh. There's only one way that you can get to heaven, and that way is through the Lord Jesus Christ and Him alone. Thank you, sir. Only by Him alone. And that's why we're out here this afternoon, to tell people about the great news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that one who said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give unto you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly of heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Friends, we don't like the message of the Bible, but sometimes we need to hear things that will awaken us. As I was talking earlier about your conscience, I have a great ally in every one of you as you pass by. You have this conscience, and you have the law of God written in your hearts. And as I speak about the law of God, as I speak about the demands that God places upon those whom He has created, your conscience begins to waken up and it begins to register. And it's saying to you, maybe not in words, but it's troubling you. It's speaking to you. And it's saying, in effect, whatever this man is saying to you, he's telling you the truth. This man's not after your money. This man wants to present you the truth as it is in the Lord Jesus Christ. He wants to tell you about this person, about this glorious person, about this person that turned the world upside down when he came. You cannot deny that. It would be completely foolish to deny the fact that when Jesus came around 2,000 years ago, he left an indelible mark upon mankind. Time itself was changed. The Roman Empire, after a period of time, after it had persecuted the Christians, they then officially adopted Christianity as the official religion, and Christianity went to all the corners of the known world at that time, and wherever it went, it transformed societies, it transformed families and towns and cities and individuals. This is all due to what Jesus Christ has done, and he is a reality. And therefore, friends, we're here this afternoon from Partick, Free Church of Scotland, continuing to tell you about this person and to remind you that this person is still changing people's lives. This person will still change individuals. This is all that we want to say to you. It is concerning the Lord Jesus. I'd like to remind you about a parable that the Lord Jesus told. You'll find it in your Bibles in Luke chapter 15. It's a well-known parable, but it highlights to us how willing the Lord Jesus is willing to receive those who will come to him. Because there may be people passing by this afternoon who think that Jesus is only for religious people, or Jesus is only for good people. In Luke chapter 15, we're told, "Then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, This man receiveth sinners and eateth with them." The publicans, who were they? They were tax collectors. And the sinners were outcasts. But they were the ones who were gathering around the Lord Jesus. And the Pharisees saw this, and they were alarmed. They were the religious people of the day. And they couldn't understand that Jesus, if he was truly a man of God, why was he being associated with tax collectors and sinners? He then goes on to open up a parable. And part of that parable is concerning the parable of the prodigal son. This man had two sons, and he must have been quite well off because he had servants as well. But he had two sons. And one of the sons, the younger son, said to his father, "Give me my inheritance, that I might leave and go and live my life." What he was actually saying was, "I really want you dead, and I want your money." His father agreed to his request, and after a few days, he gathered all he had and gave his share of the inheritance to his younger son. His younger son then gathered what he had, and off he went. He left the family home. He left the comfort and the security of his father's home, and he went into a far country. And what did he do in the far country with all his inheritance, with all his money? Well, he spent it. He went to the nightclubs. He went to the drinking dens. He went to the dance halls. He gathered some friends with him who would drink his money, and women who would spend his money. He was out drinking and socializing and having a wonderful time spending his inheritance. But you know what? The time came when his inheritance dried up. It was gone. There was no more money for the bars, no more money for the nightclubs, no more money for drinking. And what's more, he had no more friends. The friends that he had entertained before had left him. They had gone. They hadn't got money, and they couldn't support him. And there he was, without money, in a far country. And what else happened? We're told in the parable that a famine came. Now, in these times, there was no social security, no help, no soup kitchens, none of that. He was starving. Starving, starving, hungry. He went to work in a piggery and he wished that he could eat what was given to the pigs, but no one would give him anything. Nothing whatsoever. He ultimately came to his senses. He said to himself, here I am starving. No one will give me anything. In my father's house, even the servants eat better than this. I'm going to go back to my father. So he gathered his things and began to go back to his father. What kind of reception do you think he would get after the way he treated his father? He said to his father, basically, let's get rid of you and give me my inheritance so that I can go and spend it. What kind of reception was he going to get? Well, the Bible tells us that his father was looking for him. And when his father saw him coming, what did the father do? The father ran to him. Ran to him. Here was an old man running. This was not a mark of respect or honor for the Jews to do that. But nevertheless, here was the father willing to embrace his son. He ran to him, embraced him, and kissed him. He was so delighted that his son was back. He was so delighted that his son came to his senses and came back to the family home. The son offered to be a servant. I'm not worthy to be your son any longer. Let me be a servant. The father says, no, no, no. He put a glorious robe upon him. He put shoes on his feet. And he created a great party for him, a great feast to welcome him home. He embraced him. And all his misdeeds that he had done before were forgotten. The father was so overjoyed that he had his son back. It was like life from the dead for the father. Jesus told that parable that we might understand that that is the way that he welcomes sinners. He welcomes those who have been in the far country, who have spent their money and their lives on trivialities and sin and lust and all of these things, and who have come to their senses, and maybe they're wondering, will Jesus accept me? Considering what I've done, considering my sins, considering my uncleanness, considering how I have wasted my talents and my money and everything, how my life is ruined, but will Jesus welcome me? This parable teaches us that if we will come, if we will but repent, if we will but believe, if we will but receive the Lord Jesus Christ, he will receive us. He says on another occasion, all the Father giveth me shall come to me, and whosoever cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. That's a promise. In God's word, you'll find it in John's gospel, a promise uttered by the Lord Jesus Christ himself. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and whosoever cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. The Lord Jesus cannot lie. He is worthy of our trust and admiration. He will receive all. But surely, our problem, your problem this afternoon is you don't see your need of Christ. The prodigal son, after his money was gone and he was starving in a time of famine and no one would give him anything, he came to realize he needed his father. He came to realize he needed to eat and drink, otherwise he would die. And he went and returned. Friends, we must recognize that we are in need. We are in need just like the prodigal son. We might not experience it. We might not appreciate it. But the Bible's picture of us is quite stark. It tells us we are dead in trespasses and sins. What does that mean? It means we don't have the life of God in us by nature. We are sinners by nature. For there is no difference, as it says in Romans chapter 3, 23. For there is no difference, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All of us have missed that mark that God has set. What is that mark? That mark is absolute perfection. And we have to acknowledge we have missed that mark. What is the first commandment? The first commandment is, thou shalt have no other gods before me. And it's true. If we honestly look at that commandment and unpack it and understand it, we are idolaters by nature. What is a god? A god is something that takes the place of the real God. If we're thinking about ourselves continually, from the moment that we get up to the moment that we go to sleep, then we ourselves are gods. If we're thinking about our work, about our homes and property, about our money or lack of money, about our husband or wife or sons and daughters or whatever, our entertainment or sport or whatever, if these are things that are taking up our lives and taking up our affections and our thoughts, and we do not have any thought for God, then we are idolaters. We have broken the first commandment. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. The Bible also tells us in James chapter 2 that if we have broken one commandment, we have broken them all. So therefore we've broken all of God's law. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. What do we do in the Lord's day? What is the Sabbath day? The Sabbath day is Sunday. It's the first day of the week. It's the day when Jesus rose victorious over the grave. It's a day when that has been set apart to publicly and privately worship God. Do we do that? What about the fifth commandment? Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Do we give reverence and honor and respect to our fathers and our mothers and to those who have authority over us? That's what that commandment teaches. Thou shalt not kill. I'm sure everyone passing by this afternoon has not physically killed anyone. But have you been angry with someone without a cause? Have you got a grudge against someone without a cause? Do you hate someone in your heart without a cause? If that is the case, then you're guilty of heart murder. Have you spoken inappropriately to someone? Have you given someone a piece of your mind on an occasion and spoken rashly and harshly without a cause? Jesus would tell us in the Sermon on the Mount, that is murder by words. What is the seventh commandment? What is it? Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not commit adultery. That commandment teaches us that sexual fulfillment is to be found in marriage between one man and one woman, and any sexual activity out with that is unlawful in the sight of God. If we've done this, we've committed adultery. Even to look at someone, for a man to look at a woman lustfully, that is committing adultery in the heart. Thou shalt not steal is another commandment. You might not have gone into a shop and stolen something, but do you pay your taxes as you should? Do you give to your employees what you should as an employer? These are the things that are covered in that commandment, thou shalt not steal. Do you give to God what belongs to God? God is the one who has created you and formed you. God is the one who has given you life. He gives you air to breathe, water to drink, food to eat, clothes to wear. God has given you innumerable gifts. What have you given to God? You are to give to God the worship that's due to his great name. That's what's required of you. If you haven't, then you're breaking that commandment. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness. You must tell the truth, not just when you go to court. And when you're a witness, you must tell the truth. But in our everyday conversation, we must tell the truth, always. There's no such thing as a white lie. Tell the truth. We are to speak out. If we see someone who has been wrongly accused and we know the truth of the matter, we are to speak out. Thou shalt not bear false witness. Are we always true? Do we always tell the truth? Are there times when we'll tell lies? Then we have broken God's word. We have broken God's law. We are sinners, therefore, in his sight. Thou shalt not covet. It's the 10th commandment. What does that mean? It means you shall not lust after something inordinately. Many people lust after something. They want to get it. Whatever it is, it might be an object. It might be a position in life. You're not to covet things. Covet what belongs to someone else. The more that we look at these commandments, the more that we recognize we have broken them. We have fallen. God demands perfect obedience. We've never, ever perfectly obeyed the word of God, the will of God. How then can we ever be in glory? How can we be reconciled to God? Here is the good news of the gospel. What is it? The good news of the gospel is that Jesus Christ, he has perfectly kept God's law. He has perfectly kept God's law in thought, in word, and in deed. He never sinned at all. And the truth is, as the gospel will tell us, if we trust upon the Lord Jesus, his righteousness is given to us. That's what happens. There's a great transaction, a great divine transaction. God punishes Christ in our room and place. We receive his righteousness. That's what we call being justified by faith. Therefore, we have peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ, through what he has done. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. We're here this afternoon from Partick, Free Church of Scotland continuing. We want to bring you some good news from the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. You're welcome to join us anytime. At the Lord's Day, Sunday, 11 a.m. and again 6:30 p.m. And we also meet on Wednesday for a midweek prayer meeting at 7:30 p.m. You would be more than welcome to all of these. Remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh, when thou shalt say, we have no pleasure in them. There's an exhortation from the wisest man that ever lived, save the Lord Jesus, from Solomon. Solomon, who tasted all that life could give him. He had 700 concubines and 300 wives. He had riches and wealth and honor and prestige. He had everything that this world could give him. Yet this was his advice. Remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh, when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them. Therefore, friends, now is the time to seek the Lord Jesus Christ. Now is the time to get your eternal destiny secure. This is the day of grace. This is the day when the gospel has been proclaimed to you. This is the day when you have been reminded about what Jesus Christ has done, that he has come to seek and to save that which was lost, that he has come on a mercy mission, that he has done all that was required in order for people like myself to go forward and to preach the gospel and to tell you people to come and to believe upon him and to receive him as your Lord and Savior, and you will receive the gift of eternal life. Your sin shall be forgiven, and you shall be reconciled to God, and when the time comes, you shall be welcomed into heaven itself. That's all there in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And may God bless his word to you this afternoon.